Amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to do the teaching of the word tonight, and the Lord gave me this message, and it's about enlarging your heart. You know, God does not look upon the outward appearance. He does not look at your outward appearance, but he looks at your heart, and he looks at what's in your heart, and he wants to make it bigger and bigger and bigger, so that we can receive more and more of him. That's what it's all about, to receive more of God himself, his very presence in us. And we thank the Lord for that. And I'm going to start in the book of Psalms. King David was one that he had a large heart. And that was through his communication with the Lord, his worship of the Lord, and also the love that flowed out of him. And it's in Psalms 119, verse 32. And it says, I will run the way of thy commandments. I will go the way of thy commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart. And so King David, he wanted to even have a bigger heart and a bigger heart and a bigger heart. And so he says, and when you enlarge my heart, Lord, I'm going to run after your word. I'm going to run after your commandments. And so that's one of the reasons why the Lord wants us to have a larger heart, is so that we can receive more of his word, get more of his word down deep inside of us, because it's the word in you that makes the difference. The more word you have in you, the more anointing, the more power, the more ability to function in this earth. And remember Sunday night, as we studied about walking as kings, the more you have in your heart, the more you can walk this out. You know, some people just have a head knowledge. They just know what the word says. They've memorized the scriptures. They can quote it back to you. They can spit it out. You know, you say, well, what is, you know, Psalms 119:32 says, you know, they can tell you what the word says, but they have not begun to walk. And that's what we want to do. It says walk, we're to walk by faith and not by sight. And so we want to enlarge our hearts for that very reason, so that we can run and do his commandments. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now let's go to 1 John 4:8. I know you don't have your Bibles right here with you, but in 1 John 4:8, a familiar scripture that says, well, in verse 7, it says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth God, not God, for God is love, and love is God. And so when we ask the Lord to enlarge our hearts, that's what's going to happen. He's going to come in and bring his presence into our hearts. And that's what actually makes it bigger and bigger and bigger. You know, in Romans 5, verse 5, it's the Holy Spirit that sheds the love of God into our heart. So this is by the Spirit. It's a supernatural thing. God's love is supernatural. We cannot see it or touch it, or it's not visible to us. But I guarantee you, a person who has a large heart, you can tell that they've been with the Lord. Isn't that right? You can understand where they've been, because we do not get the love of God except by the Spirit of God. So the more relationship we have with the Holy Spirit, the more you pray in tongues, the more you pray in the Spirit. It says that you will build yourself up. And part of that building up is enlarging your heart so that you can love those that are unlovely. You know, I thought that I loved people, and I've talked about this before. I thought that I had lots of love in my heart. But then we started the mission downtown, you know, where we minister to the prostitutes and the drug addicts and the homeless people and who, you know, lied to us, who smoked crack cocaine in our building, who even brought weapons, you know, into our building. You know, they didn't look like us, they didn't smell like us, they didn't drive the same kind of, they didn't drive anything. Most of them were on foot. And so I asked the Lord one day, I said, Lord, I need more love in order to work in this mission that you have brought us to, that you have created, that you have started. I can't do it without your love. And he began to supernaturally, by the Spirit of God, enlarge my heart so much that, I mean, the mission has been closed how many years?
Since
2006, the mission building was closed, and even today, I can, you know, that was what, 15 years ago. Even today, I can go downtown Athens and get out of my car, and the minute I get out of my car, I hear, Sister Sherry, Sister Sherry. And it's the, you know, it's the people that knew us and that we knew them, and we formed that love, and God enlarged our hearts to be able to love them and to minister to them, and they received it. You know, there are three things that remain. What are they? Faith, hope, and love. Our faith, hope, and charity. And it says, what is the greatest of these?
Love.
What is, love. That's right. Love is the greatest of those three, and it will never go away. Faith will never go away. Hope will never go away, and love will never go away. Those three things remain. It says, and the greatest of these is love. It's the greatest of these is love. And so we want our hearts to get so big that God's presence will be so flowing out of us that other people, it says that they shall know us by what? Not by the gifts that we had, not how intelligent we are. They shall know us how? By our love. That's how they're going to know us. That's how the world is going to know you. That's how the workplace is going to know who you are. That's how your family is going to know who you are. And is by the love of God. Is by the love of God. And, you know, in Romans 8, 39, it says that nothing shall separate you from the love of God. If you've got love in your heart already, then he's just going to add to it. He's just going to keep adding to it. The more you study the word, the more you pray in the Spirit, and there will be opportunities for you to love. There will be opportunities. And I guarantee you those opportunities are very challenging sometimes. And so when you ask the Lord for more love, I guarantee you he's going to give you an opportunity to love somebody. to love somebody, and it may not be exactly what you're thinking, but the love of God never fails. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 13. And we've taught on this before, but I think it's worth going back over to tonight. And that is, what is love all about? And I'm going to start with verse 1. Because though I speak with the and I'm reading from the King James, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I have become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. That means that I am making a sound that is not profitable. It's not doing anything. It's not productive. And though I have the gift of prophecy and I understand all mysteries and revelation and knowledge, and though I have all faith that I could remove mountains and I don't have any love, I am nothing. So tonight we're talking about enlarging your heart and enlarging. And I'm believing the Lord. I'm believing the Lord tonight to pour into me even more love. I want more of God's love in me. It says, love suffers long and is kind. Now, that word suffereth there, that love suffereth long, that word there does not mean sickness, disease, poverty. It does not mean anything that's evil. What does that word suffer mean? It means, because Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me. That word suffer here in the Greek means to allow God to move in you. That's what that word suffer there. So it says, love suffereth long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not exalt itself. Love does not get puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemingly or seek it his own, is not easily provoked. Ooh, hallelujah. And thinks no evil. Rejoices not in sin or iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Hallelujah. And the more we rejoice, it says in Philippians 4, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. And the more you rejoice in the Lord, your heart gets a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger, a little bit bigger. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopes all things, endureth all things. And I love this verse right here, verse 8. Love never fails. So the love that is in you, God's love, God is love and love is God, it will not fail. People cannot resist. And this is what the Lord told us a long time ago. Love never fails. And people that need Jesus, they cannot resist the love of God. The love of God. You know, I was walking downtown Athens one afternoon and I saw this young woman sitting on the bench. And as I walked toward her, I heard what she was thinking and what she said within herself. She didn't say it out loud. What she said within herself was, I hate you and I want you to die. And I heard that.
That's what she said about you.
That's what she said about me. And so I got closer and closer to her, realizing that this young woman was into not only witchcraft, but she was into Satanism. And because there's a difference there. And so I deliberately went and sat on the bench next to her. Now, if I had been afraid, I would not have done that. But see, the love of God keeps you from fearing. Perfect love casteth out fear. So I was not afraid of this young woman. I wanted to speak to this young woman. And before I left that bench that day, that young woman came to Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It was all about the love of God. Hallelujah. His love wanted to speak to her. And I know that you know people like that. People that need Jesus. People that need help. People that need a touch from the Lord. And that's why we're talking about enlarging our hearts tonight. And just getting more of his love. More of his love. More of his love. More of his love. You know, and it says here, if we go on down to chapter 14. No, let's read 13 of the chapter 13. And now abideth faith, hope, and love. Those three, but the greatest of these is love. Because that's God himself. And what I want you to get into your thinking tonight is that the God within you is love. And so the more you allow him to work in you, inside of you, the more love you will have to give to others. When you speak to them, when you pray with them, when you let them know about who Jesus is. So let's go to the first verse of 14. Follow after love and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you would prophesy. You know, even prophecy is done through love. All of the gifts work through love. The more you love, the more your heart is enlarged, then God will use you in the gifts, because the gift of prophecy, the gift of wisdom, the gift of word of knowledge. Why does God do that? It's because he loves the people. And so that's why we need a large heart. Hallelujah. We need that enlarged heart. And so let's think about John chapter 8, verse 3. And
Sherry, before you go there, I would like to tell about a story, and I'll lead into it and
sure.
finish it. And that is, there is a difference between God's love and man's love. And when we had the mission, we had it for 8 years in the center of this city, Athens. And there were congregations, the main congregations, the first congregation of this, the first of that, the first of that. They were all around us.
All around us.
Within just a few yards. And one day there was a young man that we ministered to in the mission, and he had gone into one of those congregations, into one of those buildings where they were about to have a service. And he said, I just wanted to see what happens in those services. And the reason I bring this up is that you can say you have love and you can say you love people, but there's a difference. There's a difference between God's love and what people say is love. And so everybody that says love doesn't mean that they are actually operating in God's love. And when he went into one of these big congregations, church buildings that was within a few yards of the mission, he went in and sat down. They were about to have a service, and one of the ushers came to him and got him up and got him by the arm and said, we don't allow your type here. We don't allow people like you to come into our building. And so they basically threw him out of the church building. And that's really significant, because they wouldn't minister to him, wouldn't allow him to come into service. And supposedly they were talking about Jesus and the love of Jesus, but they didn't represent Jesus in this situation, and they didn't reflect his love, and they didn't pour out his love to this young man. And And so the young man came back to the mission where we were and said something to Sherry. And so what did he say to you, Sherry?
Well, he said that he said on the very back row by the door, he said, I didn't want to cause any problems. I just wanted to see what went on in their services. And so he sat down in the chair and he said, but I don't belong there. I don't belong there. And so we want people to know that they belong, that they are valuable, that they're important. And this, what this happened to this young man, already he was in a situation that, you know, he had tattoos all over his body. He had piercings, you know, he, you know, wore a leather jacket, you know, so already he was an outcast to most of the quote, church people. He was bad news, but yet this young man was hurting on the inside. This young man had run away from home because he was beaten by his dad. And so this young man needed the love of God.
But if this big congregation couldn't love him, they couldn't accept Jesus in their midst. They would not have right. been accepting of Jesus. And it would have been no different than the religious group that crucified Jesus. They either accept him, accept his love, accept his people. If you've done something to one of the least of these, then you've done it unto me. And if you've rejected one of the least of these who's seeking Jesus, then you've rejected Jesus. It's a significant, it's a critical thing mm-hmm. about the love of God and how we love one another. And everybody who says they love people do not carry and express the love of God.
Amen. And that's really what we want tonight, is for the Lord to touch our hearts and to enlarge it, even when people don't do what we think that they should do or ought to do, or the response. Many times, you know, I've talked with people and thinking that I would get a certain response back from them. And when that response did not come, then I would get, you know, upset. I would get angry. But yet the love of God, we just read that the love of God is not easily provoked, and it does not envy it. It does not get puffed up. And so, and I'm going to talk in a few moments about things that clutter the heart and just like the physical heart. I'm not a doctor, you know, however, but the physical heart, people have to have stents put in. People have to have open heart surgery. Why? Because their arteries are clogged up and the blood is not flowing freely through that physical heart. Well, it's the same way with your spiritual heart. But I want to go to one more passage before I start talking about how do we clean out our heart. And in chapter 8 of John, it says that Jesus was on the Mount of Olives. You know, that's where he liked to go many times to pray and to fellowship with the Father. Oh, Brother Fred went to his rock this morning. Tell him what you saw at your rock.
Well,
went early this morning.
I go to my rock, which is by a stream and a waterfall, and I sit there and communicate with the Lord. He and I speak when I sit there by the waterfall in his presence. And this morning I went out early because it was getting warmer. And when I got there, approaching my rock, there were two deer. So it was wonderful to see mm-hmm. those deer there. The deer pant for the water.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
As the deer panteth for the water, my soul longeth for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Jesus was there on the Mount of Olives, and he comes, and early in the morning, he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him, and they sat down and they wanted him to teach them. But the scribes and the Pharisees brought him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now, Moses in the law. Now, remember, Jesus was a man of the law, but because of the wilderness experience and 40 days of fasting and being in the presence of the Holy Spirit, he became a man of the Spirit. Okay. But they're trying to take him back into the law. Be very cautious if someone is trying to take you back into the law. Because you are free. Hallelujah. You're free. Liberty is in the Spirit. And Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned to death. But what do you say about this? What do you say about this, Jesus? And they said this to him, tempting him, trying to catch him in something that they could accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. And when they continued to ask him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. Now, so what do you think Jesus wrote on the ground? I mean, I'm asking, what do you think that Jesus wrote on the ground?
Love.
Pardon?
Love.
Love?
Yes.
Yeah, hallelujah. It certainly could have been, Ruth.
I once read that, some comments, like I said, just a story. Some people think Jesus stood there, our Lord stood there, write some names. Names, those among the people.
So he was writing down the names of the people?
Shouting to stone him, kill, stone him. And then who? And then they said, well, later on, people just went away from the oldest to the youngest.
Yes, that's the very next verse, George.
If you self-righteousness and without true love from God.
They did not have true love. That's right.
Nobody is without sin. Nobody.
Amen. Amen.
And just Dr. White pointed that out. I think when preaching to the second word is very important, it's a love. We do not have the word agape. And the philos, the other kind of thing in English, we usually say love. And
that's right.
People usually can give an example, for the young people, the lovers, that maybe today, say, well, I'm the happiest person in the world. And then maybe several months later, they quarrel and they become bye-bye. It's already kind of polite. Some people even get kind of enemy. That's not the love.
I'm talking about agape love.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. And it says when Jesus lifted up himself and saw, after they all began to leave, when he said that, Jesus lifted up himself and saw none there. And he said to the woman, where are your accusers? And she says, there's no man. And there's none. And Jesus says, neither do I condemn thee. Jesus does not condemn us, but the Holy Spirit will convict us. If we need to go another direction, if we need to repent, the Holy Spirit will convict our hearts. And that's, again, if your heart is enlarged, to receive the presence of the Lord and receive his agape love, like George said, then you're quick to repent when the Holy Spirit says, well, you know, you shouldn't have said that, or you shouldn't have done that. Then we are quick to repent and come back in line into righteousness. And he said, she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. You know, I believe that, you know, he could have written on the ground mercy, because his mercies are new every morning. I believe that he could have written forgiveness, because he is the one that forgives sin. Hallelujah. He could have written down their names, like George said. You know, he could have, to make them know that he was making an account. He was taking an account of who was there and who was accusing her. And so I think that's something that we all need to consider, because I'm going to talk about those things that clutter up our heart and make our heart less receptive to receiving the love of God. And so the Pharisees therefore said unto him, thou bearest record of thyself, thy record is not true. Jesus said unto them, though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true. For I know whence I come and where I go. But you don't know where you've come from or who you really are. And so I want to know who I am. And I want each one of you to know who you are. You are, you know, one of God's children. The Holy Spirit has poured in the love of God into you. And we need to be believing God for more of his love.
Amen. Amen.
More of his love. Now, before we come to a close here, there are three things I want you to consider that keep the heart from receiving more of God's love. And number one is found in Matthew chapter 7. Verse 1. It says in Matthew 7, verse 1, judge not, lest you be judged. So a critical spirit, always looking for, you know, a person who sees the evil in somebody else or the bad in somebody else. It says, judge not, lest you be judged. And so that judgment will come in and close up your arteries. It will close up the flow of the love that is in there by the Holy Spirit. And so, Lord, I pray for each one of us right now. Lord, I repent of any judgment that I've brought to anyone, any critical spirit that I might have had, in Jesus' name. And Lord, I repent, and I ask that you clean all of that out, clean it out of my heart, that my heart will be pure before you, and that I will be ready to receive more of your love in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And the second thing that clutters up the heart and makes it not receptive to the love of God is pride. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, it says, verse 6, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. And the very next verse tells us how to keep our heart pure, how to keep it clean, how to keep the love flowing out of it. And it says, casting all of your care upon him because he cares for you.
Yes,
that means no worry. That means no anxiety. That means no fear. That means no panic. That means that you are believing the Lord. Humble yourself under his mighty hand. And it says that he will exalt you. And then verse 8 says, be watchful, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion — it doesn't say that he is a lion, Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah — walketh about seeking somebody that he can devour, seeking someone that he can come in and clutter up your heart. If he can get someone to worry, then it stops that flow. It stops the flow. And so we're not to judge. We're not to be critical. We're not to be prideful. And so to make that, put that in the positive sense, it means that we are to be forgiving, that we are to show mercy to one another and to those people that say things that hurt us or do things that hurt us. You know, this is the positive part. And that we're to cast every care over on him. You know, we're to get up in the morning and believe the Lord to order our steps that day. You know, I had one woman tell me once, she said, if I did not believe that the Lord was ordering my steps, I would go insane. That's what she told me. And I took hold of that. And I said, Lord, you know, I wake up every morning and I'm believing you that you're ordering my steps.
Amen.
That we're supposed to be doing whatever you tell us to do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so, and the third thing that I want you to consider about the cleaning out the arteries of your heart, and that is, some people reject the word of God. And every time Pharaoh rejected the word of the Lord, every time Moses went to Pharaoh and said, let my people go, and Pharaoh rejected that, it says that his heart was hardened. And so we need to believe the word. We need to act on the word. We need to say, I don't understand this word, but it's in the Bible, it's in the scripture, and I believe it. And I'm believing the Lord to show me and give me understanding. There's been lots of scriptures that I have not understood. And lots of scriptures that I've said, Lord, I don't understand this scripture, but I believe it because it's in your word. I'm not going to reject it.
Amen.
I'm not going to reject it. See, that kept my heart open. It kept it enlarged so that I could receive the love of God.
Hallelujah.
You know, there's a little chorus that says, just to know the love of God that reaches down to fallen man and lifts him up from out of sin where he has trod. Just to know that God is real. Hallelujah. Do you know the rest of it? Anyway, then you know nothing until you know the love of God. You know, and that's what enlargement of the heart is all about, is that we know more and more about how God operates. You know, we're his children. We are being conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, his son. And that's all done through the supernatural. But as I was sharing with you, just like with the physical heart in the natural realm can be clogged up. It can be clogged up with things that, you know, a person's diet, no exercise, and then all these other things, judgment, pride, rejection of the word, all of that will keep that heart from being enlarged. And so I speak over you tonight, right now, in the name of Jesus, that God will enlarge your heart. that God's love will be poured out upon you and in you, and that you will begin to walk in a greater anointing and a greater power because your heart is enlarged.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. I receive it.
In the name of Jesus. Enlarge our hearts, Lord. Hallelujah. Keep us from worry. Keep us from anxiety. Keep us, Lord, from being fearful. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Love never fails. God's love in you will never fail. Hallelujah. And Lord, that's why we want more of you, more of who you are in us.
Amen.
So that when people see us, they don't see Sarah. They don't see Joy. They don't see George. They don't see Freddie. They don't see Ruth. They don't see Gwen. They don't see Sherry. But they see the love of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And so I'm going to